وصلي وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد، continue إن شاء الله تعالى from the book of صحيح الإمام البخاري رحمه الله. And we are in كتاب الأدب, the book of الأدب or manners. And we reach the chapter باب ما لا يستحيا من الحق للتفقه في الدين. The chapter of what should not be shyness from the truth, from the haqq, للتفقه في الدين, to comprehend and to learn the religion. The previous chapter was about the haya, and we had that last week. Al-haya is shyness or modesty. And this is the khuluq of the deen of Islam, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إن لكل دين خلقا وخلق الإسلام الحياة. For every deen, it has its khuluq, it has its manner. And the manner of the deen of Islam is al-haya, shyness and modesty. And as we talked about it last week, that shyness, when it's mentioned like this in English, it has a negative connotation to it, and it makes a person think of someone that is obsessive, or someone that is whatever the negative meanings. But al-haya is a beautiful word, and it's the manner that if a person has it, it would protect him from doing anything that is disliked or anything that is against mannerism and goodness and so on. And there is a haya that is mandatory for every single Muslim to have, and that is to have this shyness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all watching us and He is the all-hearer, the all-seer. And we have to have that shyness that will protect the person from falling into the sins and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the shyness from our own selves, that a person doesn't degrade himself to evil doing and so on. And also the shyness from others is a good thing. It prevents the person from doing what is evil. And of course with the sincere intention that a person do things only for the sake of Allah. And we heard the hadith last week about the man from Al-Ansar. كان يعظ أخاه في الحياة. He was advising his brother not to be shy. And the Prophet ﷺ passing by, and he saw him like this, and he told him, دعه, leave him alone. فإن الحياء من الإيمان. Because indeed, الحياء, modesty or shyness from an iman. And when he was advising him in a way that he's telling him that قد أضر, that it harmed you. For you to be shy, it harmed you. And many people, they say that to others. Don't be shy, it will harm you, this and that. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, leave him, because it's definitely from an iman. So something that we need to raise our children to have, and it's for both men and women. And the Prophet ﷺ, the one that faced the whole entire world, and all different types of people, the enemies and the friends and everyone, he ﷺ كان أشد حياء من العذراء في خديه. As the hadith also Sahih Bukhari, that the Prophet ﷺ was more shy than a virgin woman in her private bedroom, where she is the most shy when she's in that place, if someone would all of a sudden enter on her. The Prophet ﷺ was more shy than this case. So this is the Prophet ﷺ, and he is the leader of all the Muslims. He has this level of shyness. That's why Amr ibn al-As, when he was dying, and he said to his son, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, that his life was in three stages. In the first stage, that he was an enemy to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said that he, if ولئن رأيته, there was nothing more beloved to me than يكون هناك أحب إلي من أن أقتله. There was nothing more beloved to me than to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was before he became a believer and a Muslim. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought the iman and the guidance in his heart, and he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet ﷺ extended his hand to Amr ibn al-As to make the bay'ah, the pledge of Islam. Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he took his hand back. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, مَا لَكَ يَا عَمْرُ, what's the matter with you, O Amr? He said, أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَشْتَرِطْ, I want to make a condition before I'm a Muslim. So he said, what is the condition? He said, أَنْ يُغْفَرَ لِي, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, أَمَا تَرَى أَوْ أَمَا تَدْرِي عَمْرُ, don't you know, عَمْرُ, that أن الإسلام يجب ما قبل, that Islam wipes what's before it, and الحج المبرور, also the righteous حج wipes what's before it, Then he said, I became a Muslim. And then he said, after the first stage and how he had this towards the Prophet ﷺ, he said, then there was no one more beloved to me than the Messenger ﷺ. And he said, and I could not even look at him in the eyes because of how much the love and the respect that he had to the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, and if you ask me to describe to you how the Prophet ﷺ looks, I will not be able to, because لم أكن أملأ عيني منه. That means I would not give him my full look into his face out of the love and the respect that they had to the Prophet ﷺ. And then after that, after the Prophet ﷺ said this is the third stage, he said, and this is out of his humbleness radiallahu anhu, that at dunya took us left and right, but I died on one kalima, which is La ilaha illallah, and it was the last words that he said, and he died in that state, one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. So the point is that the love that they had to the Prophet ﷺ, that had also this shyness from them, and the Prophet ﷺ would not even look at them into the eyes for a long time, as also a sign of the shyness. So after that, and this from the fiqh and understanding of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he brings the next chapter in the same subject, but to make the matter clear that when it comes to al-haq, there's no shyness. Shyness is not in the context of saying the truth, right? Because if a person is shy, he might be shy to say the truth. He might shy to learn the deen. And the hadith will explain this. So this is not shyness, and this is not the shyness that is mentioned. Because shyness should not prevent the person from learning what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him, should not prevent the person from saying the truth and concealing the truth when it's needed. This is a sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned Bani Israel for doing this and made it the responsibility of those who have the knowledge that they have to convey the message and not to conceal the truth. So this is why he meant this, especially with tafaqquh fi deen, to learn. And that's why one of the things that would prevent the person from learning the deen is al-haya. Many people, they don't learn how to recite the Quran because of they think it's out of shyness. They don't want to be embarrassed, for example, when they recite the Quran and make mistakes and people might laugh at them or something like this. So who's the one that is losing at the end? It's the one that didn't learn. But when a person has the sincere intention for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is deen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most high, a person should take the means and seek help from Allah. Then he says the hadith, يقول حدثنا إسماعيل قال حدثني مالك. مالك is Imam Malik رحمه الله, Imam الدنيا at his time. يقول عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه. أبيه, his father is عروة بن الزبير. عن زينب بنت أبي سلمة عن أم سلمة. So the narrator of the hadith is Umm Salama, the wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قالت, she said, جاءت أم سليم إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت يا رسول الله إن الله لا يستحي من الحق فهل على المرأة غسل إذا احتلمت؟ فقال نعم إذا رأت الماء. أم سليم, and Umm Sulaym is the mother of Anas رضي الله عنه. She came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and she said to him, O Messenger of Allah, يا رسول الله, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala لا يستحي من الحق. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have shyness from the truth. And she gave that beautiful introduction because of what's coming next. Then she asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, would there be any ghusl or any shower on the woman إذا احتلمت, if she has احتلام. الاحتلام comes from الحلم. الحلم is the dream. But usually the word حلم refers to the dream that is from shaitan. Because the dream is of three categories. الرؤية, which is the good dream, when a person sees something and has signs, and it's from one of the levels of the nubuwwah of the prophethood, and it has signs and so on. So this is the رؤية, the good one. And there is أضغاط الأحلام. The أضغاط الأحلام is the stressful dreams that has no meaning to it. Person was busy the whole day with whatever was stressful for him, so he sees things that doesn't make sense whatsoever. Right? This is أضغاط الأحلام, has nothing to it whatsoever. And the other type, the third type, is الحلم. الحلم is the bad dream. It's the dream that a person would wake up upset and sad and doesn't feel good. Sometimes even wake up, you know, think that everybody died or he died, or people think that this is might happen or this is something, a sign or something there. الحلم من الشيطان, as the Prophet ﷺ said, this is from shaitan. He wants to make you upset, he wants to make you sad. And a person should definitely not to miss the adhkar before going to sleep and make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if it happened, the Prophet ﷺ said he should not say it to anyone, because فَلَنْ يَضُرَّهِ, it's not going to harm you. It's just the shaitan. Shaitan likes for you to talk about it and to be upset and to make people maybe concerned or whatever. It has nothing to do with what's going to happen, and a person should ignore it. So the word احتلمتو comes from that word, but it means when a person would have, as they call it, and there's no shyness in that as a religion. احتلمتو is a very polite word, right? But they translate it as wet dreams. When a person would have the seminal fluid comes out that when a person is asleep, that means he has to make ghusl. And this is common among men, for those who are not married and so on. But for women, this is not something that is common among them. So when she came and she asked the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ answered. And the hadith, of course, is an evidence that a woman to ask such a question, this is a person might think that this is against shyness. And the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, they had the best shyness. But this is deep. That means if she doesn't know the ruling, she might be making salah when it's not valid salah. And that's why it's very important for the girls when they reach the age of puberty that they learn matters of tahara and najasa and impurity and so on, and the mother should teach her and things like this. And it's true that some of them, they would fast Ramadan out of shyness when they're not supposed to fast, because they're embarrassed to break their fast, right? Of course they don't have to eat in front of everyone, but they would fast not knowing the ruling, and they say it's better than breaking the fast, even with their niyyah, with their intention, not knowing the rulings. Or they would pray with everybody when it's haram for them to pray, but out of the embarrassment that it's going to look obvious and things like, especially the young ones. So this is something, there's no shyness in this. The matter should be explained, and they should know the rulings of matters of the deen. And here Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha, she's coming to the Prophet and asking. And another narration, when she said that Umm Salama radiallahu anha, she covered her face and she said, "You expose the women this way, right? Because this is something that women would be shy to say that or to mention this." But the Prophet ﷺ said, "Yes, إذا رأت الناس, if she sees the water, that means if something came out, then she has to take the ghusl and to take the shower." And as a rule, anything that, even breaking the wudu, anything that comes out from the front of the bed that breaks the wudu, or sometimes a person has to make a shower if it's like the seminal fluid and so on. So this is the first evidence here. The second one, he says, حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا شعب قال حدثنا محارب بن دثار قال سمعت ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مثل المؤمن كمثل شجرة خضراء لا يسقط ورقها ولا يتحاد. فقال القوم هي شجرة كذا هي شجرة كذا. فأردت أن أقول هي النخلة وأنا غلام شاب، فاستحييت وقال هي النخلة. وعن شعبة قال حدثنا خبيب بن عبد الرحمن عن حفص بن عاصم عن ابن عمر مثله، وزاد فحدثت به عمر فقال لو كنت قلتها لكان أحب إلي من كذا وكذا. الحديث came before. Where Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنه, he said, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, one time he was saying, the example or the parable of the believer is like a green tree. Its leaves doesn't fall, and it doesn't fall and doesn't die and things like this. So the people, the Prophet ﷺ was asking them, what tree is it? And the question by itself from the Prophet ﷺ shows the kindness and the goodness of the Prophet ﷺ with his companions رضي الله عنهم, asking them a question that does not have necessarily a ruling, but it has a great benefit, because it says this is the life of the mu'min, right? So the believer. And the parables and the examples are many in the Quran, and it has great benefits. That one of the greatest benefits of giving an example is that it brings the non-physical meanings to be as if it's something physical, so that the person, the matter is very clear to him. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran in many ayat. So when the Prophet said that, the people start saying it's the tree of so and so, or the tree, mentioning the names of the tree of Al-Badi, the trees that they know in the desert and so on. So Ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, he said, فأردت أن أقول هي النخلة, I wanted to say that it's the palm tree. But I was, وأنا غلام شاب. I was a young boy at the time. فاستحييت. I was shy to say it. And among the people, the elders present. And it shows the goodness of Abdullah ibn Umar raised to be shy. That when the elders are present, he does not just say things, and people sometimes think that this is out of the self-confidence that a child would have, that he should not be shy in front of anyone, he should get up and speak. But this is not appropriate. Right? When there is a person that is older, he has to be respected. And this is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يُوَكِّرْ كَبِيرَنَا وَأَرْحَمْ صَغِيرَنَا. He's not one of us, the one that does not respect our elders and does not have mercy to our younger ones. So to respect the elder, it does not mean to be abused by the elder, but to respect them. And one of which is not to speak unless they would speak, to let them first, to give them the drink first, and so on. And in some situations, when the Prophet ﷺ, next to him was Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, and the drink came to the Prophet ﷺ, and there were present those four elders. After the Prophet ﷺ drank, it was the turn of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, and the Prophet ﷺ asked his permission, can I give it to someone else before you? He was a young boy. So he said, no, because he would not make ithar. He doesn't want anybody to take his turn after the Prophet ﷺ, to drink from the same spot that the Prophet ﷺ drank, to have his barakah and his blessings. He doesn't want to prefer anyone over this. So he was not being like disrespectful, though he wants the good for himself after the Prophet ﷺ, and chose the permission. Prophet ﷺ is asking the permission from the young boy, not to say he's a young boy, who cares, give it to the older one. No, but asking, this is his right. And when he refused, he gave it to him. And he did not refuse in a bad thing, he refused because of the love that he had to the Prophet ﷺ. So that's why the etiquette said that our elders is to start with that. Because sometimes people say, should we start with the right or with the elders? The person say, coming into the room with a drink or food or whatever. Should he start from the right or from the, goes first to who? He should go straight to the elder among them. And then the right from the elder. Unless the food comes to him and he's sitting, and they're all sitting next to each other, then the one that has the right is the one to his right. But if he's walking in, like he goes straight to the most respected one, the elder among them, and then from there it goes to the right. And these things with the practice and the children of being raised in such an environment, this is something that, again, al-haya and the respect is our manners as Muslims. Right? So we should not say the environment and this and that, and we see our children are acting in a different way than the way we were raised. And we're not talking about culture, we're talking about matters of deen. So Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he was shy. And he knew that it was the nakhla or the palm tree. But Umar radiallahu anhu, later, when his son Abdullah ibn Umar told him that I knew that it was the nakhla, he said to him, لَوْ كُنْتَ قُلْتَهَا لَكَانَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ كَذَا وَكَذَا. If you have said it, it would have been more beloved to me than such and such. Because this is would make something, make Umar radiallahu anhu so proud of his son, that he's a young boy and he knows the answer, and the elders are not, they did not know it. So he was encouraging him that if it happened, he should have said it. So correcting him that this is maybe not the right context of shyness, because the question was given to everybody. So if someone asks a question, right, and everybody's sitting and the child is sitting, it's not out of shyness that he, if he knows the answer, to be quiet, but to ask for permission to give an answer. So this is nothing wrong with that, as what said by Umar radiallahu anhu. The last hadith in the chat is just حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا مرحوم قال سمعت ثابتا أنه سمع أنسا يقول جاءت امرأة إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تعرض عليه نفسها فقالت هل لك في حاجة؟ فقالت ابنته ما أقل حياؤها فقال هي خير منك. عرضت على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نفسها. So a woman, she came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and she عرضت نفسها عليه وسلم, she presented herself to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, offering herself for marriage to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So she said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, هل لك في حاجة؟ Would you like basically to marry me? And the Prophet, so فقالت ابنته ابنته هير and again some people when they don't have the right understanding and they don't learn the deen from the ulama they can cause so much harm and this is an example it says فقالت ابنته his daughter said daughter of who right a person has to understand the thing with the context the daughter of Anas رضي الله عنه the narrator of the hadith right so not the daughter of the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam it's the daughter of the narrator of the hadith so a person has to know these things and that does not come by just some of the translations even to this hadith mention that فقالت ابنته his daughter said and the person doesn't know whose daughter is So he said, "ما أقل حياءها." She said, "How less is her haya that she came like this?" And she said that to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said to her, "هي خير منك." Anas رضي الله عنه. He said to his daughter, "She's better than you." She offered herself for marriage to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right? And who would be more honored as to be from the mothers of the believers? Right? This is a high level that nobody can reach among the women. To be from Umm al-Mu'mineen, to be from the mothers of the believers, and the Prophet ﷺ would not marry someone unless she would be in Jannah. Well, these are the wives of the Prophet ﷺ in Jannah. But and also this concept of marriage and things like this, when Muslims get affected by whatever the environment they live in, people look down at marriage. People consider marriage as a filthy thing, right? The deen of Islam, it's a beautiful thing, right? And something that a Muslim should be proud of. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. That's why there is an ayat in the Quran and a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the hadith here to show that is it permissible for women to do that or not? First of all, it's against the shyness of the woman, right? As a general ruling. And that's why even the daughter of Anas radiallahu anha, she said that. But since this is a special case to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, And also, as the Quran they say, if a woman can do that if it's someone that is righteous and so on, and she's not going to expose herself, she's not going to commit a sin, she's not going to humiliate herself. And also, one of the sunan that is being deserted is not necessarily the woman to do that, because the woman, she's supposed to be, as a rule, she is someone that is matluba, she's not taliba, she's not seeking. And that's why even these... websites or whatever, women seeking men, this is a shameful thing, right? A Muslim woman, she should not seek marriage in general, right? She's supposed to be sought, right? The man's supposed to seek marriage and she is protected and so on. But a person would say, how would she then be known, right? A righteous woman, she would know the righteous women in her community, they get together, they read Quran and the masjid, they know each other, things like this. But of course, it doesn't mean that it's haram. As long as there's no haram is involved, right? Then the matter is haram. But the matter of shyness is important. But also one of the things that is neglected is for a man, for the guardian of a woman, like his father, for example, to look for a husband for his daughter. Like this is something that they did with the Prophet ﷺ, like Abu Bakr anhu, when he went to Umar and to Uthman with regards to his Umar he went to Abu Bakr and to Uthman with regards to his daughter Hafsa and then to the Prophet and this is I for example I know a brother mashallah he got all of his daughters married like this he would go to the brother that he thinks he can be the best and he's from Canada mashallah all of his daughters are successful marriages mashallah so it's not it doesn't have to be that way, but it doesn't take away from the honor and dignity and so on. Especially with those who know the matters of religion. Usually, when culture comes in place, then it ruins many things. That's why our deen is qala Allah, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, qala Sahaba. This is the deen. Is the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa taala. Whether it's matters of shyness and akhlaq and manners and so on, whether it's matters of belief. Aqeedah, whether it's matters of understanding the deen of Islam, it's a mandatory thing for us that we as Muslims, especially, and I won't take too much in the time, but it's something important for us to remember, especially the time that we live in and all of these different difficulties and so on. It's meant to be this way from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Muslims would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to have their hearts attached to Allah, to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and for them to follow the principles of this deen. That the Prophet did not return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless the matter has been made clear. It's such a sad thing that there is confusion among many of the Ummah when it comes to what is right and what is wrong and so on. On the matter of the Prophet he said, تَرَبْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْمَحَجَّةِ الْبَيْضَةِ I left you on the clear way, the clear white way, the matter that is very clear. لَيْلُهَا كَنَهَالِكْ It's night is like the day. لَيْزِيُ عَلَى الْمَهَالِكْ Only those who are deprived or perished, they are the ones that will be deviated from. What did he leave us on, Did he leave us on reason and opinions and likings and taste and so on, and backgrounds and cultures and so on? Well, he left what for us, alayhi salatu wasalam? Wahi from Allah, the Quran, and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And more than that, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this hadith needs to be studied at all levels. The hadith of Al-Irbad al-Bisariya radiallahu anhu. And when he said, وَعَظَنَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَعِظَةً بَلِيغًا He gave us an eloquent admonition and advice. ذَرَفَتْ مِنَ الْعُيُونَ That as a result of that, the eyes shed tears. وَجَلَ مِنَ الْقُلُوبِ And the hearts were softened and so on. And you can imagine sitting, listening to the Prophet ﷺ, how that would affect the heart and the eyes and so on. So they said to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, كَأَنَّهَا مَوْعِظَةٌ وَدَّ As if this is a farewell advice, أَوْصِنَا Give us your will. The very precise advice to give to us, something that after you return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what should we hold fast to? And the wasiyah is the most precise and the most important words. Right, not something that we say, I'll see you tomorrow, so next month, and so on. So the matter is still at ease. You plan to take people in a gradual way from one thing to the other because you stick with them. But وَصِيَّةٌ مُوَدَّعٌ Someone that is leaving. Right, and that's why in da'wah, if it's someone that you might not see him again, it's different than someone that you're living with him. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, still a person can leave this life anytime. But there's difference when it comes to conveying the message and the matter to be clear. So the Prophet ﷺ, when they told them this, he gave them the principles that the people who Ahlus Sunnah clearly that you hold fast to it, and this is what we need to hold fast to it at these times of fitna and tribulations. He said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, أوصيكم بتقوى الله. I give you the wasiyah, the order to have the taqwa of Allah, the fear of Allah, to be obedient to Allah. And this is a word that is general, that comes under it every single specific thing in the deen of Islam. Every order of Allah. The purpose of our life is to have the taqwa of Allah, to fear Allah, to be obedient to Him, to follow the orders of Allah, to put that forward before our desires and likings and families and everything in this whole entire world. The taqwa of Allah, the fear of Allah, the obedience of Allah. And then He said, وَالسَّمْعُ وَالطَّاعَةُ And to listen and to obey. وَإِتَامَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِيٌ And to listen and to obey even if your Amir is an Abyssinian slave, right? So to listen and to obey to the authority, whether it's a general authority or anyone that has authority over you, to listen and obey, and the sam' wa ta'a, of course, is conditioned by if it's in ma'ruf, in goodness, not in sins. No obedience for nobody when it comes to the disobedience of Allah. But many people, they have this issue. They don't like to listen and to obey. And the Prophet ﷺ in other hadith when he talked about even if the ruler is an unjust ruler, right, people they have to listen and to obey in the ma'ruf, not in sinful means, but not to revolt and all of these things. So as-sam'u wa-ta'a, and then after that he said alayhi salatu wasalam, these two things, taqwa Allah was-sam'u wa-ta'a. Why these two things? To fear Allah, to be obedient to Allah, and to listen and to obey, not to break the unity of the Muslimin by disobeying your rulers and so on. And then he said, فَإِنَّهُمْ يَعْشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا Because whoever lives among you, he would see اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا اخْتِلَافًا means many differences. Many differences, and we see that right very clearly. Then he said, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي Stay in my sunnah, my way. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ النَّهَدِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِ And the sunnah of the rightly guided Khalifa after me. عضوا عليها بالنوازل, bite on it with the molar teeth. We talked about that before, but this is something that we constantly need to be reminded. If a person follow this, he will be different than many things that is happening around us. You will distance yourself against from those who curse the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Our deen is not just the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ said, وَسُنَّةَ الْخُلَفَاءَ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِينَ الْبَعْدِ. And the way of the rightly guided Khalifa after me, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali رضي الله عنه, to follow them and to bite on it with our molar teeth, that means it's very difficult because it's nusus and text versus what people think, what people like, what people think it works, and so on. عضوا عليها بالنواجد وإياكم ومحدثات الأمور. And be warned against the newly introduced matters, because indeed كل محدثة بدعة. Every new invented matter is بدعة, is innovation. Every innovation in our fire, we have been sufficed by the way of Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. We don't need something else. We need his way عليه الصلاة والسلام, not to introduce anything, and that's what splitted the Ummah so much with all of these different ideologies and beliefs and sects. And it always starts with something small, and have inshallah 4 minutes left. Small things that a person might think it's okay, or it's not something major, but it leads to what is worse. Just the fact that a person would change something that the Prophet ﷺ didn't do. It's a simple question. If the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it, right, and it matters of deen, who are we to do it? People in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, they're always every year the debatable issues, and Muslims attack each other, you don't love the Prophet ﷺ, don't you this and that. The Mawlid of the Prophet ﷺ, even if it's been established for hundreds of years, right? If we apply this hadith, stay in my sunnah and the sunnah the way of the rightly guided Khalifa after. Did the Prophet ﷺ celebrate the Mawlid on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal in the way that people do? And he said, no, definitely not. Did the Khulafa al-Rashidin, when they loved the Prophet ﷺ more than us, did they do that? Definitely not. So who are we to introduce something that the Prophet ﷺ didn't do? And it's not something other than religion, it's religion. People would seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing this, and khutbah of the Jumu'ah and gatherings and all kinds of things like this. This is innovation in the deen. Innovation in the deen, nobody ever said that it looks evil. Innovations of the deen looks beautiful, looks religion, looks nice, looks feels good. But it's a simple question. If the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it, then it's the covenant between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we would follow the Prophet ﷺ. Even with matters of belief, with things that people make things up and so on. So this is a covenant between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to hold fast to the deen of Allah, and to soften the hearts with the dhikr of Allah. The love of the Prophet ﷺ is to follow him. Many times we talk about, even if we talk about principles and foundations and matters of aqidah, this is the most important thing, of course. Everything else is built on this. But also the Prophet ﷺ, how was his night? How was his ibadah? How was his da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? All of this, to follow him, alayhi salatu wasalam. He was mentioning a statement from Khalid ibn Ma'dan, one of the early generations of Islam, when he said an ayah that we pass by many times and we don't reflect upon. He said the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرُكُمْ وَاشْكُرُونِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونِ. Remember me, I will remember you. And be grateful to me and do not have kufr or disgratefulness or not to be thankful. He said, إِذَا قَرَتْ هَذِي الْآيَةِ كِفْ وَلَا تَعْجَى. He said, if you recite it, stop. And don't be in haste. Don't go quickly. Because فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ, remember me, I will remember you. This is an amazing one. If you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, will remember you. In a better gathering, the gathering of the angels. Right? He said, stop and do not be in haste. How are they understood? They did not say, no, it doesn't mean this, it means the reward. أَذْكُرْكُمْ, I would remember you. The names and attributes of Allah, the way it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would speak and would praise the person in front of the angels in a way that fits the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then he said, فَإِذَا رَزَقَكَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ جَلَّ يَقِينًا بِهَا, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for you yaqeen, certainty in this ayah, when you're reciting it like this, فَمَا جَفَّتْ شَفَتَكَ, your lips will never dry from the dhikr of Allah. Because if it's فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ, who want to waste his life in other than the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And the Prophet ﷺ, when he gave the wasiyah, the advice to the man, he said, "Ma yazal lisanuka ratba min dhikrillah." Keep your tongue always wet by the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The dhikr of Allah is the things that we say, is the recitation of the Quran, is doing good and forbidding evil, is the learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's all as people, when a person attend and he listens to the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he's in dhikr. These are hilaf of dhikr. These are the gatherings of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say Allah said and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us follow the way of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam and to protect us from all evil. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.